Hi, it's Dan again, back down in my basement, and we've got this massive amp for you to look at. We haven't got a massive amp for you to look at. This is the Cloudlifter Variable Impedance Instrument or Mic Activator. Quite a mouthful. Most people would say it's kind of a DI box. So let's get on and have a look at why it's not. Okay, so here we have a rather cute little box, I think. And my instrument is coming in to the left-hand side here. And we're having our signal converted in the normal direct injection method out through this XLR lead over to our recording device. Now, for a normal DI box, that's pretty much where things end. The signal goes in, it's converted for transmission over, say, long cable lengths in a system which stops noise from being picked up on the line. That's brilliant. We need those on live stages. However, Cloudlifter have looked at DI boxes and said, well, actually, what else can we do with them? How can we actually improve what a DI box is actually capable of delivering for us? So for this particular DI box, we've got some additional functionality on the front. First of all, it's active. It has got some clever electronics, some really dead silent, high quality preamp electronics, which enables us, first of all, to boost the signal and to make it have a bit more guts to it. So that's why I've picked my P bass, because it has actually quite a low output level to it. And maybe if I want to drive into, say, a PA system or something like that, and you know, the input of that is quite a distance away from where I happen to be playing, then I kind of want some boost at source. So the first thing we've got over here, and as you can see, I've actually got this switched into the high boost mode already. A 3 setting switch, and I'm boosting my output. So from these, say, vintage style pickups, the output's quite low, and I can get a nice hot signal out to my desk. For some devices, some recording devices, maybe the preamplifier on the device itself doesn't like being cranked up. It introduces noise. So Cloudlifter have gone, well, hang on, wait, why don't we use a dead silent preamplifier and boost the signal at source rather than having to turn up the gain on the recording device and introduce hiss and noise? Big tick in the box straight away. This particular box works very, very well with microphones. So in my introduction, I even said it was a microphone activator as well. So it would suit maybe recording acoustic guitar or something like that. So the fact that I'm using bass, just another tick in the box that this unit is more than capable of looking after that. So that's our first switch done. Whilst we're over here with the XLR lead, we do have a ground lift switch on it as well. That's very, very useful for rejecting noise that we may have on the line. But also, I'm powering this via phantom power. So the desk is actually supplying my power. So no batteries, no power supplies. Yeah, great. I could actually rock up for a gig with this and have this on the floor next to me, send the lead straight out to the PA. Can I have some power, please? No problem at all. That's my backline, all done. I could run into my in-ear monitors or maybe some stage monitors. Amp can stay at home. Nice. So over on this side then, we actually have a combo jack. So for example, if I'm plugging in a microphone with an XLR plug on it, I can plug that straight in. Or in this case, I'm using a quarter inch instrument lead and I'm plugging in, no problem, that fits as well. That might be enough for most people. So it sounds a pretty good start. However, we have this dial in the middle, and this is our variable impedance control. Now, what I wanted to do is I don't want to cloud things too much. But what I'm going to say is this, control allows me to load my pickups in the same way as maybe plugging into a vintage amplifier, for example. I guess we already know that, you know, plugging into vintage amplifiers, they have a particular sound or a feel to them, maybe versus the latest solid state offering from X big brand or something like that. But what we don't know is, well, how does that actually affect the sound? If I've got an older amplifier with a input impedance, which is much lower than maybe a nice modern amplifier, which has a high impedance, well, actually, what difference does that make to a passive instrument like this? It's kind of a good way of doing a bit of show and tell. So this little chap is able to emulate that situation. Indeed, when I did my introduction, I've actually got my tone control all the way open, so nice bright sound from my bass, but by using the dial here, I was able to wind the input impedance down, loading my pickups, and it changes the way that my instrument reacts, but also it definitely affects the top end. The top end is rolled off a little bit. Now, first of all, if I'm going to demonstrate this, if you're listening on laptop speakers, then you might as well hit pause now. You're probably better off getting some really nice earphones or some decent big speakers where you can actually hear the clarity. Small speakers are not going to help at all. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to wind the control around, first of all, from all the way open. So we're going to get the highest impedance setting, which is going to give us the most amount of dynamic range and clarity. And around we go. And I'm using a pick. I used a pick with the introduction specifically because I wanted the top end to be heard. Okay, so here we go then. Now in the studio through our foldback system, that's really clear. I'm getting lots of rich overtones. And you know, I might like playing with my tone control all the way open, but do you know what, actually it's a bit too bright. So let's start going around. And I'm gonna go, let's say, that's just about the 8 o'clock setting, isn't it? And I'm gonna play straight away. I'm not gonna talk too much. Have a little listen to this. Hopefully I've played that in a similar way, and if you can hear this, and you would also notice that my top end has definitely softened. It's not the same as my tone control on my bass, which, you know, almost makes it a bit more spongy, I guess. I'm trying to figure out words to describe this, really. And I come back to about the 12 o'clock setting, and we shall compare. Have a listen to this. Kind of splitting the difference, but maybe somewhere in between. I'm going to see if I can get about 10 o'clock setting. Interesting. Yeah, I'm getting a softening of the sound, but actually I still have clarity. Whereas if I just demonstrate, I'm just going to roll my tone control back a little bit. My clarity's gone. I've got that sort of nice woolly kind of tone. About halfway. Actually, I like the tone control all the way open and using this instead. That's really interesting. So using this dial, it's almost like a tone control, but different. And I like what it's doing. It makes it feel a little different whilst I'm playing it and softens the sound at the same time. obviously, you're going to want to play with this yourself. So don't take my review as gospel. You're definitely going to want to plug this in and try it out with your own bass, because, as I understand it, the impedance loading will actually affect different basses in a different way, especially active instruments, for example. Let's move on. Okay, I'm going to go back to around about this 12 o'clock setting. We have one final switch to look at on here. So in the up position, this function here is bypassed, but when I switch it down, I have a high pass filter. Now, this is being added to my impedance control, so the two work in tandem. So first of all, high pass filter, what am I doing? Well, using my dial in the middle, I can control how much frequency comes through the pedal. So at one extreme, I've got, I guess, all of my signal. And as I go around to the other extreme, I'm going to slowly lose low end. My high can pass, a high pass filter. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to roll this around. I'm going to have a little listen to the difference that makes. I'm going to start with the 15 kilohertz setting. So this is going to have all of my bass signal coming through. And let's face it, 15K is, you know, frequencies that I'm probably not really dealing with for the weight of my bass tone. Okay, let's have a listen to this. You should be able to tell already that the bass end is slowly disappearing. Let's go around to, that seems to be about 10 o'clock to me. Then finally, let's go all the way around. This final setting, I'm thinking to myself, this is going to be limited use for a bass player. I have actually lost all of my low end. I can still tell the sound of the instrument, and it sounds like a P bass, but all of that weight has gone. So don't worry, it's not your earphones or anything like that. We have basically lost the most important frequencies of bass guitar, in my opinion anyway. So I probably wouldn't overcook it and go that far. I kind of liked where we started to round off a little bit the subs. So even if I'm around the 3 o'clock setting, I've still got a good bass sound. I'm not losing too much. Maybe if I had a 5-string bass, I'd start going, I'm not so sure. But this would be a really, really useful gadget for actually filtering out sounds if I was maybe like bi-amping, I suppose, just thinking of that. You could plug into, say, a guitar amplifier as well as your bass amp. That gets used quite a lot in recording. And maybe I don't want all my low ends to go to the guitar amp. You could possibly use it for that. I was just thinking of that. So, as I said, I mean, the usability for bass guitar, I would probably watch that with the high pass filter, unless you're using it as an effect where you specifically want all the low end to go out of your sound. That could be quite useful. I think certainly for like acoustic instruments, maybe recording acoustic guitar or vocals where you want maybe less bottom end, plosives for vocals, or maybe you want a more of a percussive sound from an acoustic guitar rather than the body of the sound, then actually that could be very, very useful. And I can see that being a really good gadget to just pull out and go, right, excellent. We can create a particular texture just by dialing control rather than, you know, reaching for the digital audio workstation. So there we go. Rounding up very, very quickly. We've got a really cool solid metal box here. If nothing else, a great sounding DI. I'm getting no noise or anything like that in the studio, and it's making my bass sound really, really cool. We've got a booster here, our variable impedance control, and a high pass filter on here as well. Self-powered, phantom power, so no need for batteries or power supplies. And you could probably rock up to most gigs doing a bass job, a dep, with just this, plugging straight into the PA and away you go. Right, there we go. Some information will obviously go in the magazine about this too. But for now, cheers for watching, and I will catch you in another review. See ya.